So thank you to the organizers who did a beautiful job. And before we leave the mic today, I want to acknowledge all of them. But to move the agenda forward, I'm going to ask the chancellor to come up to stand with me. He leads this district with distinction. He cares about all of our colleges. And he, when he came on board, was quite more than smitten about this project. The Building Efficiency for a Sustainable Tomorrow BEST Center is an extraordinary resource for this community. And we are very, very honored that the National Science Foundation honored this institution some years ago with the National Center status. I'm going to ask two other key individuals to come up. They're so critical to this district. They have committed to this district for the long haul. Our trustees, the president of our board, Mr. Riley, Dr. Riley, would you please come up? And our trustee, Linda Handy. And I want to make this very transparent after you clap. She's an alum of Laney College, so we take great pleasure in having her up here as well. So I'm flanked by three critical people. They'll make my presentation even more succinct and parsimonious. But most importantly, I want to thank some other folks who are so critical. We have leaders in this community that care about this institution. Congresswoman Barbara Lee has been so instrumental in making certain that at the federal level, this district gets the recognition that it's due. And I'd like to ask the gentleman who's representing her, Principal Field Representative, Mr. Diego Gonzalez, to please join us up here very efficiently, if you're here. Oh, there he goes. Wonderful. He would like to present something to all of us, and definitely to our chancellor and our trustees, but to the greater community from our congresswoman, and then I'll come back and just share a few more words.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
So I have to say I'm a huge fan of my congresswoman, but I'm actually here on behalf of Assemblymember Rob Bonta, who nonetheless is fighting for community colleges in our district. We're proud to have three of them. So, and I think as somebody who went to a community college, I always like to come back and a little envious of some of the political science students that get to be in political science classes and talk to, you know, have the debates and discussions about all the craziness happening in the elections right now. So anyway, on behalf of Assemblymember Rob Bonta, I want to congratulate Chancellor Laguerre, the Peralta Community Colleges District, Dr. Webb for their leadership. Like I said, the Assemblymember is always looking forward and happy to be here, support Laney and Peralta Community Colleges. So on behalf of Assemblymember Bonta, who wasn't able to be here today on account of being in Sacramento, I want to present an assembly certificate on behalf of the Assemblymember to Laney College faculty and staff in recognition of the groundbreaking of your new BEST Center building to strengthen technical education and workforce pathway opportunities for our students in the development of high-performance buildings fit for the 21st century. On this day, signed Assemblymember Bonta, 18th Assembly District. Congratulations.
It's always wonderful to make a little faux pas to ensure that we are all humble, especially me. And so thank you so much for honoring us and to acknowledge our great assemblyman who cares very deeply about this and passionately about this community. Lives in Alameda, but finds Oakland and Laney College very dear to his heart. So thank you very much again. I'd like to say very briefly that there was a lot of blood, sweat, and tears, and I'm not exaggerating. There was actually some blood shed in the creation of what we now call our BEST Center. And we're gonna actualize it very soon because of these leaders and so many others in this community. That it started with a dream, a vision. And that vision was held so dear and shared passionately by Nick Chiaracapetti. He is to be acknowledged as a faculty member who was a graduate of Laney College. When he came here many years later from Greece. He chose to stay at this institution and move into the role as an instructor, a part-time instructor, helping to build out what was then HVAC, heating, ventilation, air conditioning, refrigeration. As a result of us bringing on board a gentleman who's also been deeply steeped in this community for years, Peter Crabtree, as the dean, those two mobilized with other individuals, faculty across the campus, Cynthia Correa in carpentry, Lewis Quinley in machine technology, Ron Betts in architecture, and so many others, to say, how can we transform this institution in such a way that is much more meaningful to business and industry? How can we create something that is seminal to the nation? How can we create something that reflects the best practices around the planet? And so these folks have gone to Australia, they've gone to Switzerland, they've been other places to look at the best practices, and they came back to say, here's what we ought to build at Laney College. And without further ado, I'm going to hand it off to the chancellor and say, gentlemen, you come to a district to make a major difference, and you're going to be part of the extraordinary building of a zero net energy building. What that means is all the energy generated goes back into rejuvenating and ensuring the viability of that institution. And I'm going to talk about more of the spotlights, because that's for our Dean Crabtree and others to share, but it will be a remarkable spotlight that will be transformative in terms of how students learn and engage. So without further ado, it's an honor.
Would Trustee Dr. Nikki Gonzalez-Yuan please join us?
I'm hiding behind this
pole. So I needed to make a faux pas as well to make sure that my president looks as great as she could. I just want, way before coming to Peralta, I knew about the great work that was being done at Laney College in terms of sustainability. So it's indeed a privilege for me to come in and join in the celebration that we have. With the BEST Center, it's not just another building that we are having at Peralta. It is a way for us to lead the nation, to lead some four-year institutions, to lead other companies, to lead individuals in the sustainability area. And this is, as a community college, we pride ourselves in serving our community. And I think this is definitely a great way, a great symbol of what we can do as a community college district and what our community can see in terms of the results of its investment in what we do. So I want to congratulate Laney College, its faculty, staff and students and administrators for the great accomplishment that is happening today. And we very much look forward to the great things that will happen in the building. Thank you very much. Dr. Ryan?
Thank you, Chancellor. Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Is anybody out there? Thank you. Thank you so much. It is indeed a pleasure on behalf of Peralta School Board to say welcome. I'm so lucky to have Trustee Andy, my sidekick, or my other sidekick here. What's your name? My good brother Gonzalez, who is been super active in the sustainability, has been one of our great leaders, and we thank you for that. You know, throughout the past Measure A some time ago, so that we can erect this building right here. And I know that my tennis players are really excited that this is going to be gone. Smile, please. I know, I was just kidding. But sincerely, I just want to say thank you all for coming. You know, we talk about sustainability and the technology and environment. One of the key things we have to remember that our students must be skilled in writing, skilled in the area of thinking and in mathematics. And because at the end of the day, that's what's going to carry them through regardless of what field of endeavor they go into. So once again, thank you very much on behalf of the Peralta Community College District. I want to thank my board members again. Thank you, Chancellor, President Webb. And we look forward to the ceremony and the throwing the dirt so we can move on. Thank you, County.
Thank you.
At this time, I'd like to ask Dr. Sadiqa Carl to come forward. And as he comes forward, I want to thank him for his leadership and working with our previous chancellor and our current chancellor and key individuals who he will acknowledge, who will be instrumental in making certain that this structure, the first phase of two phases, is erected and erected efficiently. So without further ado, Dr. Carl.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for taking some time out of your busy schedule to join us. I'm very elated to be able to stand before you today to be able to do the groundbreaking ceremony for this project. It's been a while we'll be trying to do this, and I'm glad that this day came. Originally, when this project was being thought of, the name of the project was a sustainable project. And that was the name we had for it. So the college took the name, a sustainable project, and turned it around as the best center, which was a more befitting name for the purpose that it's meant for. I want to acknowledge a certain individual, but before I get there, I want to have you understand what is it that this building essentially will be used for. What we're going to be doing today is phase one of the entire project. And this phase one is a training center. This center will be used as a test house, and also it's gonna be used to support training for construction, and also it's gonna be used as a performance institute house. There are three objectives that we want to achieve in this. Dr. Nora Webb, our president here, has indicated about the zero net energy, meaning essentially that whatever is going to be used in the building is going to be produced by the building itself. And then we're going to have a U.S. Green Building Council certify this building as a platinum. And the standard that we want to achieve is called Passive House. Passive House is a sort of German name of a higher standard that is a platinum. And also, last but not the least, is for the purpose of the curriculum, instruction, or career technical education that is meant for, which is the reason why we're doing this center. There are many partners that participated to be able to assist us to plan this. We are most grateful to our community partner, Emirate Cities. We had an individual by the name Tara. Tara Merchant, is Tara here today? Oh, okay, let's give her a hand. So for those of you that are not aware, Tara worked from day one with the district and the college to be able to see how we can get the type of design that will be able to fit the project. So she assisted in writing a grant that led PG&E to award an estimated amount of $300,000 towards the technical support of the planning of this building. So your achievement here is well recognized for as part of community effort to make this happen. So, but there was a team that met week after week that did all of this. So if the team, if I call your name, please stand and hold any applause until we are done. I have Andrew Cunningham from FLAD. He's not here right now. But we have Steve William, please, from FLAD Architect. Steve. Then we have Atheria Smith, who is the new director for planning and development, Atheria. Then we have Charles Neal, who is our director for sustainability. Charles will not be here right now, but he was part of this effort. We have Charles Neal. No, we have Cynthia Correa. Is Cynthia here?
Yes.
Oh, Cynthia, okay, thank you very much. Then we have our beloved Nick Ikipadia. Nick?
Oh, you
killed it today. Okay. I'm glad that you are with us. Then we have Danny Beasley. And is Danny here? Okay, thank you very much, Danny. And also Peter Crabtree and all the other administrators that were part of this effort. We thank you. Please give them a plaza for that. Then I want to also recognize that behind all those meetings and planning, it was the project manager for Laney that is going to be taking this project to fruition. So we have Gary Banks. Gary Banks? Before we conclude my speech, there are individuals in the background in the Department of General Services that are acting every day in support of this kind of project. And I want to have Anna Jang. Anna Jang, thank you. Audrey Thompson. Audrey. Rosemary Vasquez. And Regina Davis. So we hope to facilitate the construction of this project for this phase one, and hopefully in the near future, when more funding is available, we continue with phase two. And phase two is going to be more elaborate than what we have right now. So on behalf of the college president, the chancellor, members of the governing board of trustees, and also our planner that made this arrangement possible, the person of Cathy Neal, please give her a hand. So on behalf of the chancellor and everybody that I've mentioned, thank you very much for coming.
Thank you. Okay, you can tell we like to thank folks, and because we understand that one person doesn't make anything happen. A few people do not make things happen. A community makes things happen. And so that's why we're taking the time to acknowledge individuals. And undoubtedly, we're going to miss someone, and we're hoping that we will not. So as this remarkable dean steps forward and gets closer to me, we're like brothers and sisters sometimes. You may not want to get too close. Who knows what might happen. I want to acknowledge someone who's representing us, another elected official, so critical to this community, who's been here for, well, I think he was born and reared here. If he wasn't, he feels like he, or at least he behaves as though he has been. He's Marla Wilson, elected official to serve on our Alameda County Board of Education. So would you please come out just to be acknowledged so people can see that this, you run around the community, get young people engaged in boxing as an alternative way to get off the streets and do something respectful, engaging, and fun. But you do much more. You feed the homeless during the holidays, and I can talk on and on about your contributions. So thank you for choosing to be here. So as Peter begins to open up his remarkable presentation, I'm going to ask Cynthia Correa, certainly Nick Caricapetti. I'm going to ask the rest of the team in the environmental, come on, start walking forward, Chuck Hadley. I'm going to ask you all to come here and flank him on either side. I want to definitely ask our director of NSF, our program manager, Larry, our new coordinator. Would you all, just members of this team, come and flank this gentleman as he gives this presentation, because all of you contributed in some viable way. Thank you.
Well, I'm going to start my remarks by also thanking some people that have already been thanked, but I think they need to be thanked again, and that is our trustees for their support. Our chancellor, who is a real mover and shaker, and we are so appreciative of him and the leadership that he's bringing to the district, and our president and all of her support. And of course, our Vice Chancellor of General Services and his staff, without whom this could never happen. And we do appreciate them very much. Tara Marchand, who played a key role in supporting this project early. Nick Chiaracapetti, the visionary. And Cynthia Correa, the doer. Oh, and Danny Beasley, yes. Who played some critical roles. This project is all about students and all about faculty and our ability to provide laboratory experiences for our students. And that's why we're doing these buildings. They're labs. And we have a concept called Campus as Lab. It's a concept that was developed by the American Association of Community Colleges. And what it does, it's fundamentally around sustainability. Sustainability, as we know, climate change, global warming. Our president has taken this to the highest level internationally. This is the greatest challenge facing humankind in our history, in our global world history. We have to solve it for the future. Laney College, across the curriculum, is a bastion of sustainable education, from architecture to electrical to carpentry to environmental control technology to chemistry and biology. And engineering, we are teaching sustainability because that's probably one of the most important things we can teach. The building that's going to be built, one of the three, is a zero net energy building. And in California, we're taking dramatic steps to promote the concept of zero net energy construction. By 2020, I believe it'll be 100% of residential, that's the goal, will be zero net energy. By the way, let me acknowledge that we have with us as well the sector navigator from the State Chancellor's Office for Energy and Utilities and Construction, Jim Caldwell. The point that I really want to make, however, about zero net energy buildings, and this will also be LEED Platinum, which is significant. But historically, the most important thing to keep in mind is persistence. Persistence. Think persistence. 1 year after the building is built, the architect has gone home, the builders have gone away, the project manager has departed. What is the building doing? Is it still a high-performance building? And that's one of the things that is been fascinating for me as we've worked in the BEST Center for the National Science Foundation and with our curriculum team. We're also working with Jim and the public utilities across California on how do we sustain high-performance buildings. And that's where the community colleges come in. We train technicians that are the frontline workers in buildings. And it's they fundamentally who must maintain these buildings at a high performance level. And in fact, just as a side note, we were talking to one of our colleagues at another district, which I won't name, which just built a beautiful LEED Platinum building. And as he was describing it, he said, but we can't maintain it. It's not persisting LEED Platinum because we can't even turn off the lights. The control system, the technicians don't know how to operate it. And so one of the most wonderful things about this building is that our technicians, our faculty, our students will have access to the building systems. They'll be able to see them. They'll be able to even check the sequences of operations and ensure that the building continues to be a high-performance building. Because that really is our biggest challenge in reducing the energy. About 40% of greenhouse gases are generated by buildings. And so it's a very big challenge to have the training and technical skills necessary for technicians to maintain these buildings. And that is the immense opportunity that this building offers to us, to really see it. It's a demonstration site. There are only a handful of zero net energy buildings in the entire Bay Area. And we are really at the cutting edge of energy efficiency in the country. So we will be on the map with this building. And we really appreciate that as well. And it will also dovetail with our national work with the network of colleges across the country who look to Laney College here in Oakland, California, as a national leader in sustainability education and building science. So this building will really help that effort as well. In fact, we were going to visit a zero net energy building in January, but we went to UC Davis instead. But anyway, that's another matter. Now we won't have to go anywhere. We'll be able to view the building and its remarkable systems right on campus. So with that, I'm going to invite us to, I think we're going to use the shovels, is that right?
Okay, so now what I'd like to do is, as we ask one of our key leads on a lot of these organizing events, Kathy Neal, I want to acknowledge you for organizing this, thank you, and for working with another key individual at Laney, who goes in red right now, Christy Blue. So thank you two for organizing us today. We really appreciate it. I want to also thank Peralta TV, Jeff Heyman, and the entire team for your leadership and support of capturing this event and making certain that so many folks are here. As our Dean Crabtree was going to indicate, we're going to transition into the shoveling of the dirt. We're going to dig, and we're going to demonstrate the power of the Chancellor to pick up dirt. Just laughter. He didn't hear me. Dr. Laguerre? Chancellor Laguerre. I just provided a fascinating joke, and I used your name. So we're going to follow you, and we're going to ask everyone to follow us as we engage in, very good, the ceremonial experience, breaking ground.
My name is Talene, and I am also part of the homelessness. If you came by and talked to us, you probably saw our stats. We took a survey of 526 people here in the Bay Area. I think 186 were in Oakland, 132 in Alameda, the rest around the Bay Area. The stats that we did get were incredible because economic was really low. Lack of skill and motivation actually beat it by a lot. So if you wanted to come over here later on, we also have a little game. You can tell me what you think people thought. I want to introduce Robert, who is an attorney here in Alameda. It's a little better when he has his own story, because my topic was foster children and aging out in the system. And if you don't know what aging out is, it is when you turn 18, you are on your own. You are no longer underneath the government's care. Robert?
Hi, welcome. Thanks for inviting me out. My name is Robert. I'm an attorney in Alameda, and my parents died when I was very young, and I went through a series of 13 foster homes as a kid. I was fortunate that I found a family when I was 12, so from the 12 to 18 swath, I did have a family, a permanent family that I was with. A lot of the people that I grew up in the system with right at that period of time, my parents told me when I was 16, they said, you're out at 18, just to let you know, you're out the door and you need to figure it out. So you're either going to school, which I didn't have the money for, or you're gonna go and get a job or join the military. Those were the options. So I chose the work option, and because I didn't really have the skills, I didn't really have the network of people and a family, basically, when you run into tough times, you're all alone out there. And I started doing research a while back about how many, the percentage of people who were homeless came from the foster care system or had, you know, some connection with it. And as it turns out, it's very, very high. So there's an institutional bias, I think, that if you're biological within a family, I have my own kids today, they can stay until they're 30, as far as I'm concerned. They can stay with me always, I'm always wanting them in. But for many foster care kids, you're 18 and you're out the door, and a lot of times there's not really the services or really the education to tell you what your life is going to be like, or where you go, how you really advance in life. So we're here today at Alameda College, and community college was a great place. So I'm an attorney now, but it all started with a friend of mine saying, what's your plan in life, me not having one? And then I said, well, maybe I could go back and get my degree. And I started at the community college system, took me 5 years to get the 2 years, and then went to UC Berkeley, which I was not getting into out of high school, and then was fortunate and got accepted at UC Berkeley and finished law school there. So years later, everything's great, everything worked out, but there are a lot of people in the foster care system that don't get that family. There's also a bias against younger children. When you're very young, everybody wants the young ones. When you get older, you're seen as having more problems, there's more baggage, there's more this, so it becomes more and more difficult. So,
I wanted to ask you, you had friends that were in foster care?
I had friends in the foster care system, and one of the reasons that they really went to this family and told them to really kind of put pressure on them, to like, is there any way you can take this kid? Is because, like, at age 13 and 14, this is in inner city Chicago, things start to get very, very dire, and you start to get involved in a lot of different things. So I had a lot of friends whose stories are completely different than mine, and they were just in the system just a few more years than me, and didn't get that call, and their life is, you know, homelessness and jail and drugs and a lot of different things. So the connection between homelessness, it's not one that's apparent. So I think it's a great great topic and great research, because it's not something, and I think that's borne out in your research, right? Is that when you ask people, is that an influence on the homelessness? It's a fairly low percentage of people that say that that's an issue, but in actuality, it's a very high percentage.
It was a very low percentage
of 32 people.
32 out of 526 people. I can't see it because it's so low that it doesn't give me a percent. So, it's low.
We want to thank you again for listening to our presentation. My name is Tamara. This is Talene, Jaria, and Skylar. We also ask you to sign the petition that we started on change.org. It is a petition to build transitional housing in Alameda and some of the vacant homes and areas on Alameda Point is our suggestion. There's also a negotiation that's happening on December 15th at City Hall with Alameda Point Collaboration. If you want to look up on that as well. But we do have two places where you can sign a petition.
What do they do on the
base? They're gonna negotiate about making transitional housing.
And we also have flyers on things, volunteer opportunities and things you can do to help around the community. Even if you don't go to these places and help, there's always ways you can help personally, so.
Thank you.
Hi everybody, my name is Alicia, and this is my group. This is Kevin and Mauricio, and we decided to do our research on mentorship. You know, we came up with some really good statistics, and also some very alarming statistics. And according to the U.S. Department of Justice Bureau of Statistics, about 1.6 million people are in prison right now in our nation. An alarming 25% of these people are under the age of 25 years old. And even more alarming, 68% of these people do not have high school diplomas. And so, you know, it's really scary because the U.S. Department of Justice Statistics also says that juvenile crime peaks between the hours of 3 and 7 p.m., right after school. And so what can we do, you know, to get these kids off the street? What can we do for less mass shootings? What can we do? We want to advocate more programs, more mentorship for these hours. And so that's why we came up, you know, with Scholar Buddy. We're hoping to implement that program onto the campus. And another reason we wanted to do that is because in Alameda County, we have about 1.5 million residents. It's a pretty big number. About 385,000 are under the age of 18 years old. Alameda County only offers nine active youth programs. It's not sufficient enough. We need more. We need to advocate more positive behaviors into our children. We need to advocate more positive behaviors into the youth so that it can carry on to adulthood. We want higher education to be a priority. You know, in a community that's growing and higher education is so important, you know, high school dropout rate is at an alarming. It's 500,000 kids dropped out of high school last year. 500,000. It was about 3.4% for the entire nation. You know, these are scary numbers. And so that's like I said, that's why we wanted to instill, you know, more positive behaviors, more mentoring programs, especially advocated for after school. We also did some other research about the prefrontal cortex. Did you wanna?
Sure. So biological psychology is why we looked on why people make bad decisions in their adolescent years. And part of the reason is because of brain development. The prefrontal cortex on the brain is in charge for good judgment, decision making, stuff like that, and it doesn't develop or fully mature until our late teens or early 20s. So we want to be there for the youth that are going through these weird years of the brain development and try to be a supportive and help them guide them to making better decisions that won't affect them negatively in the future.
Bottom line is that we want to advocate that everybody here has the ability to create positive change. We want to remind the youth, we want to remind our children, we want to remind ourselves of our worth. We want to remind everybody what are we here for, and that is to help each other.
Thank you.
Our topic that we decided to do was food deserts, and we decided to do this topic because we knew what it was, but we didn't really know like a lot about it. So we wanted to dig deeper into what it was and find awareness to it and find different solutions that could help food deserts. What a food desert is, it's an area, an urban or rural area, which is difficult, where it's difficult to obtain fresh produce that is nutritious and affordable. And food deserts exist all over the United States, but one specific area that is a big issue is in West Oakland. And we did research on different fallacies, different arguments why people, whether people believe it's real or not, and different solutions where we could bring awareness and try and help eliminate the food desert in West Oakland.
A lot of things that we focus on when we did our research is we found different articles and evidence, and we saw that a lot of people don't even realize that food deserts exist, nor do they even believe that food deserts exist. We necessarily kind of ignore the fact that suburbs are kind of basically by definition considered a food desert. They live in an area where it's at least 10 miles away from an actual grocery store in comparison to, for instance, West Oakland, which we focused on, that also lives about 10 miles away from a grocery store. And so why is West Oakland considered a food desert versus, let's say, Piedmont? And we say this because Piedmont is wealthier. They have more resources, they have more money, they can go into a car and drive a few miles to go to the grocery store versus the families that live in a poor area like West Oakland, and they don't have the means to really jump in a car. Some people don't even drive, they have larger families, and walking across the street to the so-called liquor store or grocery market that sells, you know, processed food is a lot easier than, you know, hopping on a bus and riding for many hours or just to, you know, get a few fresh produce. And then we also forget that fresh produce, you know, goes bad faster. And so how easier it is for that working mom to stock up on processed food versus every week or even a few days to go to the grocery store on that bus just to replenish to help their family eat healthier. So it's a lot, it's definitely difficult, so.
You know, today, West Oakland makes up 17% of Oakland. And that means that 17% of Oakland isn't getting an adequate amount of, you know, good quality food into their diet. And what we found out that it wasn't just supplying this healthy food. You know, right now there's absolutely no correlation to the vicinity you live in, you know, with a grocery store and the amount of nutrients and good quality food you actually put in your diet. So you can live a block away from a Safeway right now, and Safeways can be, you know, relatively expensive. You can live a block away from a Safeway right now and still not put, you know, these good foods into your body. And so a huge solution towards this isn't just, like I said, supplying the food, but it's also educating the individuals and the residents about the food and how to put it into your diet. You know, if we can accomplish both those, then, you know, we can solve this issue. But until then, it's not just supplying the food. We need to educate the residents too.
Our study that we chose was actually rape culture. And it's present in a lot of ways, more ways than what we are actually always fully aware of, or we get the time to pay attention to. You can see it in commercial ads, such as Dolce & Gabbana, if you look at them. Rape culture basically shows that a man is supposed to be sexually dominant and aggressive, and it also takes away the voice of a woman and her right to say no to something that she may not be comfortable with. And silence is somebody's right to say no is never really okay. And then another thing that we noticed too, there are songs such as like Blurred Lines, and you think about the title, it's talking about a man being frustrated with the woman sending mixed signals about what she is okay with. And when that happens, I think a woman should be able to say no without a guy pressuring her and asking her, I know you want it, are you ready, and stuff like that. And instead, it should come in a more respectful way, because when we normalize sexual behaviors that are inappropriate, it starts to linger into all of us unconsciously. So looking at these things, we need to be more aware of them, and that's one of the solutions. Another thing about rape culture as well, there's a lot of myths and stereotypes, right? And in these stereotypes, they say things like, men cannot be raped, she wanted it because she dressed a particular way. If she's dressed in a particular way, that doesn't mean that she's promiscuous in any type of way. It could just mean that's the way that she wants to dress that day. And another thing is men who come forth and they tend to say that they've been sexually assaulted against, they're often perceived as weak or less than, but that's not always necessarily true, right? And another big topic, what happens usually, women may go to a bar and somebody may drug their drink with roofies or things that we are all pretty much familiar with and seeing in media. And we see it pretty often. And this instance right here is saying that the only way to win a woman over is to drug her and to get her to do the things that you want her to do. So that's the meme that we see on social media, and that's what we're accustomed to seeing. That's the environment that we're used to being placed around. And after seeing those things on TV repeatedly, we become desensitized to it, meaning that we look at it as something that's normal, and that's what rape culture is. It says that it takes the blame away from the victim, and it puts it makes it acceptable behavior for a man. If you look around in this picture right here in particular, there are 3 to 4 guys standing around watching, and her hands are placed back like she has no right to say no. But if you also look at the picture, she's faced upwards like this. So somebody, whoever was taking the photograph, had to instruct this. So if you think about that, it normalizes a lot of things that we see. And rape culture is present. So now we want to talk about what can we do to prevent it, or slow it down, or what can we do to all get involved, okay? So another thing that we could all do is, I have like a brochure if you guys want to go ahead and look at it too as well. We could all speak out against it when we see something happen to somebody else. They may not be in a space to say no at that moment, or they may not have that voice to say it. But if you can step up and you can speak for them, then that would definitely help. Another thing about rape culture is when we see memes like this on Instagram and social media websites, is not to support it, don't like it. If you want, you can speak against it. So it's about speaking up and having that voice to speak for people who don't have the opportunity to do that at that present moment. And another one that I had was, if you hear people saying derogatory terms about the opposite sex or stereotypes about another person, you know, speak out and say it again. Say, you know what, I actually don't agree with that. I don't believe that it's okay to, you know, demean women or look at men in a particular way. See, another thing about rape culture is, like, if you look at the Axe commercial, you can actually see that a man has to have a particular item in order to attain a woman's attention. Now, every woman is going to have her particular things that she likes about a guy. It's not going to be one item or something that you need to have to get her attention and grab her that way. So I think that these stereotypes, they affect all of us, not just women and not just men. They affect everybody. And the way we can really do it is speak out against it, and that's the way we can slow down rape culture. So that would pretty much be the solution.
My name is Wanda Sabir, and I was the lucky person to be the professor of these brilliant scholars. And my colleague, Professor Steve Gerstel, come on up, Steve. Tell me about this wonderful grant that he wrote to embed a librarian, you know? It's great to have an embedded librarian in your class. Steve, you want to tell them about your grant?
Well, it was to improve student success through improving research skills, learning about the research process, selecting good sources of information, and then incorporating that into research and to a presentation or a paper. And that's basically it. But also it's to get students motivated to find out, to realize that they can find out about the world, that they have power, and that the more they know, the more power that they have. So it's been great. I've been very rewarded by this, so thank you.
Well, thank you all so much for coming, and you can mingle some more. There's a lot of refreshments, so you need to take it with you.